Welcome to the video. As always, we do it outside. It's late at night, getting close to the New Year's, and you may hear some explosions going off. People tend to do that in this area. So, when you're viewing this, it will be 2015, and very, very auspicious year. So, we're going to just recap a little bit what we do here in these videos. And today I was going over everything in retrospective, and what I came up, what I found, what I saw is two things is vitally important. As we go forward, let's know what the very basis of going forward is. Why do we even try to go forward? First of all, our problem is way more severe than we think. We underestimate the severity of our continuity fear, very much so. Because the efforts we have taken to mock ourselves, really, this is existence is self-mockery. We've gone to extraordinary extent. We wanted to see what would happen if we just took it as far as we could take it. What would happen? Well, nothing happens except we get a severe continuity fear. Yeah, it's kind of like, New Year's Eve, people say, what's going to happen if I just drink as much alcohol as I possibly can? Well, what's going to happen? You're going to wake up with a hangover. So, we have like a spiritual hangover, and it's very severe, more than we can ever really account for. So it's useless to try to measure it, okay? It's going to be more severe than we realize. Secondly, our progress and our capability to dispel the spiritual hangover is much greater than we realize, much greater. And again, it's useless to try and measure it. It's astonishing how capable we are of getting free of this continuity fear. Based on how severe it is, we think we can never succeed, but actually we're able to be tremendously successful at this. So these are the two issues, and combine them together, it creates quite a struggle. Now, we think that we can never get free of this. There's this notion that maybe we can bind ourselves into such confusion, we can never get free of it. But keep in mind two more variables. One, we don't need it. We don't need self-mockery at all. We don't need belief in time, space, process, and form. It's totally unnecessary. We don't need to complete what we are. We can't change what we are. You know, there's no need for it. That's the first variable. Second variable is we don't like it. We don't want it. We don't like it. So, you put those two variables together, it's a powerful incentive. You see, how do we get the will to even start on the spiritual path? How do we get this will? And the answer is we don't need it and we don't want it. And one more variable is what we call duality, is an attempt to have co-allegiances. Have an allegiance to truth and allegiance to lies. Okay. Have an allegiance to what we are and have an allegiance to mockery of what we are. You can't do it. You can't have co-allegiances. You can't have this co-allegiance is impossible. When we try to blend this allegiance into one unified co-allegiance, we experience total chaos in our mind, actually, which is untenable for us. We reject it, intrinsically reject it, because it seems like we're not able to choose anything, and we were created to choose our experiencing. So we say, no, intrinsically we reject it. This is what I discovered back in 1978. Now, so the goal of self-mockery, which claims that it can reach this mystical, magical belief goal of co-allegiance, is false. This is something I've actually experienced directly. So I know directly through looking at it, experiencing it, and knowing what it's about, it is absolutely false. So for me, there's no doubt about it, that the goal of self-mockery can never be reached. It can never be abided in. It can never be abided in. The goal is to unify the allegiances, have this dual allegiance, the truth and lies, and that we'll somehow be able to abide in that. We cannot abide in this. It's impossible. It's intrinsically impossible. This is what I discovered. We can't change the self. So the self is still there. What we are, truth is still there, and it says, no. No, this, I cannot abide in this. Chaos. Cannot abide in chaos. So, the goal is impossible. And then once I realized the goal is impossible, I said, well, that's it, let's set it down. Whoops, continuity fear. Now, What is the continuity fear? Well, ultimately what it is fear of the good news. The good news is that we can set it down. And this is just shocks us, because we believe like there's no way. You know, we fashioned it to be permanent. Okay, we fashioned it to be permanent. We're as if this is the new reality, our co-reality. And then we find out we can't make it a co-reality. It's impossible. And our reality rejects this notion of co-reality. So our reality still is completely intact. And so self-mockery is just useless. It's never going to reach, it's never going to be transformed. Okay, it's just going to continue to be suffering. And then we don't want it. We don't want it. So we say, okay, and then we realize we can set it down. And I can set this down. That's too much. I did too much. You know, it involves so much, this self-mockery. We don't realize it involves, you know, time, space, process, form, and bodies, and the whole dream of existence and worlds and the universe and all this. It involves all of this, actually. And so the good news is we can set it down. But it shocks us. I said, whoa, wait a minute. We're not quite ready for that. And so then this is the trouble. You know, it's like, what do I do? What do I do? And so the continuity fear causes us to sort of stagger forward and say, well, and be in a sort of uncertain state of mind. But the progress that we're making is actually tremendous, absolutely tremendous. More than we realize, and the help we're getting is way more than we realize. It's just we're so worried about setting it all down. We tend to hope like maybe I'm not getting so much progress. I hope I'm not getting too much, you know. And this causes, you know, the problems is we think maybe no one's helping me. Maybe I'm not making any progress. Deep down, we're kind of afraid. Like, I hope I'm not making too much progress. But the fact is, we are. And so this is what I'm teaching or sharing. This is the core problem we have. We're actually making more progress than we realize, and it's very difficult to tolerate. It's very difficult to tolerate this progress, and sometimes you just want to quit. Like today, I just wanted to quit. So I don't even know if I can make it to 215. You know, let's just die today. I can't make it. This is terrible. Meaning, I'm making too much progress. I'm scared. This is what it really means. That's what I told myself. I said, hey, you know, it's. The only problem there is the continuity problem. And my fear is the fear of success, that I'm having too much success, which is true, actually. I'm on the brink of setting it all down. And so that is very, very jittery, very nervous. And we delay. And in that delay, we rationalize the delay. And it gets difficult, but at least we can practice what I call the wowism, full stop in the wow. And this requires patience, gentleness and patience, and not struggling with the struggle. Don't struggle. I think the analogy, read an analogy where you know, if a cow escapes from the barn or something, you don't go chasing after it with a stick. You try to lure it back, attract it back with nice fresh food. Say, here, look at this food. Come on, and try to track it back into the barn. But the cow will like stop and say, wait a minute, you know, and get uncertain. So you have to be very patient. You can't run after it with a stick, because then it'll take off and won't trust you. So, well, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, means we're attracting ourselves back to what we are. You know, we're attracting this, trying to have the idea of setting down self-mockery as being attractive. And so we'll settle a little bit down, you know, and then we'll like, you know, grab a hold a little bit again. And say, I don't know. We're loosening our grip on it. Actually, it's on the ground, but we're gripping it tightly. And we're loosening our grip, and if we go a little too fast, we'll like tighten it again. And just we say, okay, tighten again. Don't struggle. In other words, don't start yelling. Don't use the stick. Just full stop and say, it's fine. I know I made a lot of progress, otherwise I wouldn't be tightening my grip again like that. So, and then when we calm down, then we say, oh, okay, I don't have to let go. I don't have to let go of all of it. So, okay, I can loosen it. This is how we make rapid progress. And it takes a lot of discipline. Is we're patient. We realize we're making more success than we realize, that we can even almost fathom. But that's causing a tightening up then, a sort of reaction, a continuity fear reaction. And we just say, that's fine, okay. I expected that, that's great, good. That's a sign that I'm making a lot of progress, great progress. And then we just full stop in this wow. And don't struggle with the struggle. Don't struggle with the grip. We say, oh, it's tightening up. And say, don't tighten up, don't. No, we say, it's fine. Tightening up's fine, it's not a problem. Not even worried about it. Just remain very like neutral. Just remain very neutral. Full stop in the wow of this. Not planning like, how am I gonna get that grip beyond? No, just let yourself know that it's okay to tighten up a little bit here. That's okay. Par for the course. You know, you don't like beat yourself up if you make par on most holes. Then your game will put too much pressure on your game. Your game will start falling apart like on the golf course. You say, I didn't make a birdie. That's terrible. I'm an idiot. You know, what's the matter with me? My swing must be wrong. And you come unglued. You just say, okay, it's fine. That's good. Doing good. Going along fine. And again, it's a sign of great progress. Would you get this wow, this reaction, like wow. Wow, that's fantastic, wow. And you get nervous, a little nervous. Because you see, hey, wait a minute, maybe I could just set this all down right now. Just set it all down right now. This feeling like, I think I'm gonna do this. I think I'm gonna not set it down actually, but let go of it. See, we don't realize it's set down because we're gripping it so tightly. It's already set down actually. There's nothing we need to do to set it down. It never was off the ground in the first place. Never had wings in the first place. The self-mockery has no basis whatsoever. None, zero. So it's already on the ground. It's just that we're gripping it tightly. We don't really realize it's on the ground until we let go of the grip and say, oh, boom, there's no drop. You know, there's no sudden thud. It's, oh, nothing happened. It's already, see, there's nothing to it. There's nothing to it. So the problem is success, is managing our success on the path. This is it. And I saw how the combination of all these factors, the success is so fast and the problem is so severe. We're just like, we seem really burdened by this. And it is a burden. And I saw all the spin-offs that can happen of this. All the spin-offs. There's so many, I didn't see all of them. I recognize all these tricks we play, and having gone through all these tricks, and it's all due to these basic variables, actually. So we don't really have to search all these spin-offs of combinations of reacting to this answer. We just say, full stop in the wild, don't struggle with the struggle, and have some faith that we're making tremendous progress. I can read the great teachers and I get what they're saying. I say, yeah, this is basically, you know, what the realizations of having. This is what I'm nearing all. It's just, oh no, okay, fine. And like, wow, that's a big deal. That's a huge, huge thing. Are you kidding? That's fantastic. But you know, how do you, it's like, wow, I get it. And then it stuns you. You say, wait a minute, how in the world did I get here? And so another variable is that we cannot explain the spiritual path to anybody else. We cannot explain it. The only way you will get it is to actually do it. Everybody wants an explanation. It's impossible. You cannot explain it. Because the struggle, you know, is so severe that in looking back, only hindsight will show it to you. But even hindsight isn't an explanation, it's an actual seeing. It's not an explanation. You have to actually see it. Explanations never suffice. never suffices, because it raises the explanation, well, how did we concoct all this dream anyway, which is a vastly complex, intractably complex and burdensome a story that we certainly are not going to try and trace that at all. And so similarly, the stupendous help we get on the path, how do we account for it? We can't do the accounting for it. Only in hindsight are we able to look back and see, get a clear picture and see and say, wow, I see what the struggles were all about. You cannot know ahead of time what it is that you're struggling with. It's not clear. It's not clear. And there's no way to clear up that confusion except to actually do it, to practice, practice, practice. So I say, wowism is practice, practice, practice. And this is what I believe those who look back in hindsight will tell you. You have to practice, 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 because it's like someone who's never played the piano listening to virtuoso and saying, can you explain to me how you do this? It's a ridiculous question, right? It's an absurd question. And the answer is practice, 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 practice. And the virtuoso say, one day I had never played the piano before too. Never. And I played a little bit and I decided, you know what, I want to do this. I really want to do this. But I didn't know how. So I just practiced and it was what do we don't need this dream, we don't want it. So it's a motivation. And this is the key. And how do we get this motivation? This is the mystery. Okay, this is the mystery. And we can't really understand it because we think that God hates us, is angry at us, that we're don't deserve it. And all. So we cannot fathom God as long as we're mocking God, you see. And since this is setting down mockery of God, of ourselves, of reality of God, it's incomprehensible to us how it is that we could keep sustaining this momentum. Because, you see, we have a false will. When we're in this mockery, we have this false will of mere plausibility and magical belief that if we all agree on self-mockery somehow, it will magically become what we really want and actually what we need. What we need, it'll magically become, and it doesn't. But this brings about this wishy-washy lack of will. We substitute for a lack of will, thinking that we don't need it because self-mockery will be what we need. It'll magically become that. So the problem is we lack the will to do the path, to do it. And when we realize we can't have dual allegiances, then the will comes up about him, Malcolm says, wow, I have to do this, and we start doing it, so the will is there. But how do we sustain the will? And for those who are in heavily into self-mockery, they say, it's impossible. How can I ever get free of this? I don't have the will to do it. Because what they think is spiritual will is not. It's totally specious. It's just cleverness. It's not really spiritual will. Spiritual will is when you see, I have to do this, and that's it. There's no trickeration at all. I just have to do this. Dual allegiance is impossible. This is what happened to me. I said, dual allegiance is impossible. Will never succeed. Therefore, I have no choice. I have to evaporate this continuity fear. There's no other avenue at all. And I said, I don't know how to have the will, how to stay motivated on this. And the Holy Spirit immediately answered me and said, don't worry. I'll keep you motivated. You'll be able to do it. Guaranteed. So, wow, okay, I said, look, gotta try. It's like a great piano teacher telling you, don't worry, if you're willing to practice, you have to learn to be a virtuoso, don't worry, I know how to be a virtuoso, I will teach you as you go along, and you'll practice it, and eventually you'll get it, don't worry. I say, okay, let's start practicing. And this is it, this is the story, this is my story, this in hindsight, looking back, this is exactly what happened. This is the problem is the will. You know, the will. We're afraid. How can we get the will? So when people ask for explanations, they're asking you, how can I, without any will, keep myself motivated in order to become virtuoso? It's impossible. How did you do it? And I say, well, God did it for me. And I say, well, no, that's not possible. So the kind of a priori have a premise that how can we do it without God? You know, and you can't answer that question. You haven't. No, you haven't mocked God into submission. But they say, yes, we have. And so it's, you know, how do you explain the Holy Spirit and what his capabilities are? Cannot. Cannot. It knows every detail of every situation, past, present, and future, and knows how to orchestrate everything in light of that on an immediate basis. And so how can we calculate that? It's ridiculous. We cannot. So calculation is out the window. And so there you have it in a nutshell. And you look back, you can see in hindsight. You can see in hindsight, but not as you go along. You're just like, wow, this is not easy. This is tough. What's going on? I feel there's like these doubts that keep creeping in like shadows. Well, that's the doubt of the mockery, you know, that generates. That's the continuity fear that then clings to the mockery, and the mockery undermines a belief in the will to do it, and belief in God is helping us, and belief that we can actually, you know, succeed. And so we're always feeling undermined. And then we're tempted to go back into magical belief and believe in co-allegiance. Say, no, I'm going to go back to co-allegiance here. And then you say, oh, that doesn't work. And they say, well, how do I get the will to go forward? So it is a really tough journey, for sure. And I'm still on the journey. And it's still very tough, actually. Yes, it's still very tough. And had to pull out all the stops today. I swing from feeling I'm ready to succeed to struggling with what the world's reaction is going to be to this. And it's a nightmare. It's just a nightmare. But I had very, very good dreams last night. The night of the 30th, that would be extraordinarily good dreams that can't even be explained. Cannot even be explained. Keep in mind that we have tried to deceive ourselves to the point where we can never get free of the self-deception. So we have put a lot of confusion and trickery and all this into this dream. And so when we begin to open up and let go of it, we may have dreams and experiences that cannot be really explained at this mundane level of this just, you know, physical sensory consciousness, because the deception is way deeper than that. It's deeper than we know, deeper than we realize. So, you know, you can't necessarily explain all your dreams within mundane explanations of this world at all. You can't really teach others the path. They have to do it for themselves. It's more like a motivational thing. And so if you're enlightened, can you teach others? No, not really. Not really. You cannot. They cannot. That's not the way. They can't. They'll actually slow them down, because then they think they have to grasp it conceptually, and you can't see it clearly except in hindsight. So the real motivation is practice, 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 and that's why the really great teachers just say, hey, you know, try to say, listen, if you want what I have, the road is practice. And very few actually practice, because they say I can't have the will. But the will develops as you go along, because every advance you make, you also gain a little spiritual will. Okay. It's the important thing is don't aim. It is to have patience and realize your continuity fear is incredibly severe. So don't get down on yourself if you say, "Gee, I've been working on this for a couple of years and I'm still, you know, struggling." A couple years, you know, that's a great start. There's this sort of attitude I feel in the world now, which I call this collapse into compliance into magical belief, that you're supposed to be able to do it really fast. What this does is undermines our will. It works against us. The really great teachers never said you can do it really fast. I know Punjaji did say that. I'm not exactly sure why he said that. I don't know if it was the whole context of what he was saying, was he trying to get rid of those who were, he said, get rid of the leeches? That's a possibility. But keep in mind, it took Poonjanji, you know, a great deal of his life, since early childhood till his 40s, to get it. Plus, his previous life, he was a great adept in Krishna worship and stuff. So he'd been working at it for a long time. But then he said, well, in these days, we have a new way, and we can, you know, do it, like, right away. Yeah, yeah. No. So I don't know the full context of that, but the great teachers said, listen, just plan on a lifetime of effort. Just realize that the severity of the problem is so extreme, continuity fear. Therefore, the magnitude of the success also has to be extreme. So the extreme success you will be having is quite a shock to you. Quite a shock. And you can really almost have a lifetime of extreme break, which I have, a lifetime of extreme breakthroughs, nonstop. And still, you know, I'm still not quite there. That's how deep the continuity fear is. That's how severe our continuity fear is, you know. We thought that our mockery had an effect on God. In reality, it didn't. It didn't at all. And so... you can have a lifetime of breakthroughs, actually. So, it's not that you don't have breakthroughs. If you have a breakthrough, say it's great, but full stop in the wow, just full stop in the wow, and don't make anything of it, really. Don't make too much of it. And that will speed things up. Now, again, I reiterate that the sort of pop spirituality of the time, the idea is that you should be able to get it on a contact high with some teacher, or there's something wrong with you if you don't get it quickly, you're not very... This undermines, again, our will, because the continuity fear is so severe that the idea that we're supposed to get it quickly just freaks us out. And what happens is we go into a conceptualized getting it. We get it conceptually and then claim that this is it. And we use our imagination to imagine, you know, that we have it. And this is a big problem the world has. And so this actually hurts spiritual culture, hurts spiritual will. Undermines us, because this whole dynamic I've recognized is so touchy. It's easy to get pulled off track. It's easy to get pulled off track. If you start feeling, wow, what's something wrong with me? How come I haven't got it yet? And I need, then you start thinking, I've got to push things, and then you lose this whole patience, and the whole situation becomes muddled for you. And then you think, I can't really get it, so it must be something else. And then magical thinking comes in and says, since I can't get it, it must not actually be there as a goal. So the goal must be something else, which is then a conceptual, which is actually believing in dual allegiance. See, dual allegiance, duality again. So you just settle for what you believe is a nice duality, which never turns out to be nice. So it does require patience. There's no question about it. And the more impatient the world gets, the worse it is for us. And the world is becoming extraordinarily impatient. They want everything immediately, which is why I say the culture is going to hell. It really is. It's pulling everybody down into the hell of dual allegiance, magical belief, and which is based on a spurious will. It's not a real spiritual will at all. It's based on cleverness, the will to cleverness, the will to doublethink. This is what we're having in the world, that I see people, the way they're double thinking themselves, outsmarting themselves and thinking that's spiritual will. It's not. Spiritual will manifests itself as the spiritual path, which is this path of patience and sitting quietly, full stop in the wow, making breakthroughs, and then recognizing that we kind of freaked out a little bit, and then just accepting the freak out and saying that's okay, and being patient enough to let it settle down easily, let it gently be gentle with yourself. And then once you finally catch your breath, say, okay, I guess it's okay, and then you can go a little further, and then again you'll have a little bit of a freak out, and then stay patient. This is the way. Different people express it a little bit differently, but by and large, this is what's been expressed throughout history, is this is the way. You really have to be kind and to yourself, and forgiving. Forgive yourself. Jesus says the forgiveness is the key. This is the kindness, this is the forgiveness, because we have to forgive ourselves, saying, hey, we put ourselves on the self-mockery, trying to do the ultimate extent to see what happened. Nothing happened. We can't have co-allegiance. It's impossible. So now we're stuck with this terrible continuity fear. What is there to do except forgive ourselves? You know, and just be kind to ourselves and say, wow, I really have to, you know, have a loving, forgiving attitude to myself. This is the only thing to do. Because none of this has had any effect at all on God or myself. And yet, I'm afraid to set it down. That's a really tough situation. That's something we need to be kind to ourselves about, and forgive ourselves for ever doing this, you know, in the first place, as just you know, a real whimsical adventure. And for Jesus says forgiveness. Keep forgiving yourself. Don't struggle with the struggle. And this has this patience. Again, a culture of impatience, big problem. I like a slower pace of life. I like it that, you know, don't be in too much of a hurry. We're after hyper functionality. It's the opposite of the spiritual path. What's happening in this world is the opposite of the spiritual path, which is what? It's collapsing into this compliance of hey, we can have it. Dualistic allegiance is the way to go. So let's be hyper-functional and figure out a way, you know, that both self-mockery and reality are true. You know, that's what they say. It's both true. The reality is terrible. Can't be trusted. It's changed. It's something we hate. We're not attracted to it at all. And we're have total allegiance to this. And on the other hand, too, that it's completely attractive, that there's no basis for self-mockery whatsoever, that we're absolutely free, all is perfect, you know, nothing ever happened. And have equal, you know, have allegiance to that. Not even equal, just allegiance. Allegiance means you believe this is true. This is what I really want. That's allegiance. This is what I really want. So how can you have two situations, each one completely denies another and claim this, both of them are what you really want? Both of them, you cannot. You get chaos then. It's an absurd position. You put yourself in an absurd position. You cannot have both what you really want and the denial of what you really want and claim they're both what you really want. You can't feel that way. And only magical belief says that there's a magical transformation when you actually reach the bottom. There's not. I reached the bottom. There's no magical transformation. This is the shock. I thought there'd be a magical transformation. There was no transformation. And then I just said, oh gosh, this is terrible. I'm on the bottom and there's no transformation. What do I do? Help. Holy Spirit. Is there any help for this? Holy Spirit showed up. It's just this presence, a feeling like, don't worry, I know the way to get free of this. Don't worry, and it calmed me down. Otherwise, I would have completely freaked out to death. Really, the body could not have handled the strain of it. So, of course, if you don't believe there's any help, how can you generate the will to do it? It is not possible. And our self-mockery claims there is no help because we're mocking it. So it's a really a nice catch-22. A very nice catch-22 we're in. Or have been in. If we're mocking the very help that can help us out of mockery, obviously this is the problem. This is the trouble, isn't it? And so, and then of course we're afraid, well, if we've been mocking this help, maybe it doesn't want to help us so much. And then we get nervous about that. It's like, I can't really trust it that much, maybe a little bit. And so our trust is very feeble, you know, it's very feeble. And again, all of this explanation is lost in the instant once you're plunged into the sphere of distrust, mistrust and everything. So explanations are overvalued. What really works is the practice. Because when you can sit still for a prolonged period of time and enable yourself to get little glimpses of clarity and progress, then your will gets strengthened. And when you can just sit, don't struggle with the struggle, when you tighten up over your progress, don't struggle with that. Just let it be. Say, it's okay. Say, I know you'll relax in a little while. It's okay. Just relax. Just see if you can just stay relaxed and don't tighten up. Even though it may seem that you've stalled out, that's fine. It's not really a stall out. There's a different way of looking at it. You have to look at the situation differently so you don't start losing what your will to continue. If you look at it wrongly, you will feel like you're losing your will. And this still besets me today. It, you know, beset me, and I was afraid to drive. I said, I might have an accident. I'm so despondent. Then I said, wait, I need to look at this. Let's get the reason, the situation I'm really suffering from is too much success. Come on. You know, don't give up. I said, okay, you're right. That's right. I've had this incredible success, and I just wanted to break through, and I'm so frustrated. I cannot. And well, continuity fear. I had a tremendous success, and obviously I'm, you know, continuity fear. So don't get down on yourself, and don't think that you're failing. It's not a failure. It's a success. It's success masquerades as failure if you don't see it the right way. And then that undermines the will. So what we want is to keep the will going. Keep the will to keep on keeping on. Not giving up on the path. This path is the key to success, ultimately. So, a lot of breakthroughs, a lot of progress. I was in the room, kitchen yesterday, and suddenly I looked at it in the kitchen a different way. And I said, oh my God, I've never seen it like this before. And I realized how small it was. What a small, small space. And here I am thinking that I'm in this space, and this space is defining my experience. And I said, whoa, that is crazy. And then the idea occurred to me, is spaciousness itself contained by this room? I know there's spaciousness in this room, but aren't the walls of this room also contained in spaciousness? And the outside of these walls are all contained spaciousness. And I said, am I really what I am? Is what I am contained in this room, actually? Then I said, wow, no, maybe not. The body's contained in the room. And I realized how insane to think that spirit, what I am, is contained in this room. The body's contained, but am I contained? Is pure spaciousness contained, for example? And then I realized, wow, this is very profound. But then full stop in the wow, I just, you know, continued on doing whatever I was doing and just say, okay, that's fine. Realizing right away that the profundity, just say, okay, there's going to be a backlash from this for sure. A fear, because I would say, wait a minute. What I am isn't contained by anything. Can we put pure spaciousness in a basket or a pail and carry it like water? Is that possible, actually? Does anything contain, any structure contain what I am? Does it contain I am? Does it contain it as something, you know, separate from everything else? Is it contained like in a tank? Like compressed air, you know, the compressor is in a tank. is contained in the tank. Is pure spaciousness, can you compress it into a tank and say, I'm containing it here? Is that really possible? And if you see what I am cannot be is not contained, you realize I don't have any structure at all. And then you say, whoa, you know, wait a minute. So I realize, oh, this is going to give rise to continuity fear. Okay, let's just stay patient and calm with this, and don't get too excited here. You know, don't push it too much, okay? So it's almost like you slow down in order to speed up. Here's an example. Let's say you're going through a real tricky area of construction, under construction driving. And you know if you go too fast, you're going to get in trouble. And you're going to slam on the brakes. Maybe you'll go into the barricade, or you'll hit some cones, or you know, you'll freak out. You'll get too worried, and you'll slam on the brakes and stop. You know, it's like slow way down and get all frightened. So you say, wait a minute. So let me slow down ahead of time here. So because I know what kind of reaction I'm going to get if I try to go too fast. So I'm going to consciously, purposely slow down, so that I can go through the construction zone smoothly and then finish, go out past it, without hitting the brake. This is the wisdom of it. You purposefully slow down in order to go faster. Because if you don't slow down, you know you're going to have this reaction that's going to really put the brakes on. It's the rabbit, the tortoise, and the hare. The tortoise is smarter than the hare. Tortoise says, let me consciously, tortoise just means I'm wisely conscious. I need to slow down in order to go faster. Whereas the hare is being foolish and saying, let me go as fast as possible. And the hare says, whoa, I'm going too fast. And turns around and goes fleeing back the other direction, you know, and loses the ground that it made. This is the whole issue of the spiritual path, the tortoise and the hare. You slow down in order to go faster. And this culture is saying, no, speed up. You should be able to do it in a couple weeks. You know, to read so many websites, is we have this technique here. You'll be enlightened in a week. Just, you know, subscribe and whatever. And I'll give you these secret teachings. And in about a week's time, you should have a breakthrough in about a week and be enlightened. Or a month, or maybe just after a year, you should get it or something. This is ridiculous. So we slow down in order to go faster. This is the key. Paradoxically, like the musicians who can play really fast, actually, if they practice slow, and real slow and smooth, and they always know that they can go back to the slower smoothness, then it builds up the will to actually be able to play faster, and they won't freak out. But you can play too fast. If you're not skilled enough, you go too fast, and then you lose your bearings, and you panic, and you freeze up, and it doesn't sound good. It doesn't sound smooth. I know I used to do that. And too fast, absolutely. And it gets disjointed, and then you get panicky, and then you try to play even faster, and it gets worse, and it's a negative spiral. So the way to go is to play slower, very consciously, that I'm playing slow on purpose. Calms you down. And then put a little flourish of speed, and then calm down again. I'm going to go back slow. And so you end up playing better when you play a little slower. On the spiritual path, you slow down in order to speed up. You don't have these wild bipolar swings. You want to smooth it out. So one thing I can say in retrospective is what happened on the path is it smoothed out. It smoothed out. Became more and more steady, the progress. Whereas early on, he was very ragged and very bipolar as far as, wow, I think I got it. And then I'm just completely, you know, lost and totally, this is horrible. You know, just going to a depression. This is, and just these wild swings. And it got so bad, I said, you know, I just have to smooth it out. Got to find a way to smooth it. I cannot continue these wild swings of huge progress and then a collapse. Because I was, you know, trying, I got trying to do it fast. I said, I gotta get it done right away. And fortunately, Jesus is a teacher, which is very, he's very patient and kind and forgiving, and tells us, look, it's perfectly okay. I know if it doesn't happen for you, that's fine. Well, of course, I've been reading this for 36 years. And, you know, so it needs to be made abundantly clear. Abundantly clear in the teaching, don't try to anticipate results thinking that you should be able to get it. Doesn't work like that. Just continue to be patient and forgiving and practice. Don't think about results. What happens when you're this way, you're centered, you're poised, what happens is you get more results. Get more results. You may read something, something may occur to you, and you say, yeah, I understand that, it's very clear to me. And then it falls stop, because then you realize, wait a minute, I've been trying to clarify that for 30 years, and suddenly it's easily clear to me. And then instead of saying, what, instead of, you said, here's a good example. What happens? Know that the wow has automatically already happened. You already reacted like wow. Don't say, hey, that's incredible. You know, that's amazing. How long? That's a mistake. So full stop. Immediately full stop in the wow. Don't pursue the wow. It's already here. Just the recognition that, hey, I've just achieved something I've been trying for my whole life, and now I see it. That is huge. Now, the thing about the great teachers is that, for instance, let me give an example of a virtuoso. They're doing stuff that is just fantastic, and yet they're not shocked by it at all. So it's all smooth, it's all effortless. That's what virtuoso is all about, right? You get somebody else who can play just as good, or almost as good, but they're so overwhelmed by how great they're playing that the wheels come off. Okay, this is the problem. So there are those of us who are quite far along who can really explain and say this and all this, and yet it's like, we're like, at some point we say, oh my gosh, this is like incredible. I'm so blown away by how wise I am. And then wheels come off. Whereas the virtuoso is just giving this out, and it's like, no problem, of course. And this is what the audience likes, because they say, oh, it's easy. They're not shocked by it at all. This is what everyone's looking for. It says, how do I not be shocked by this? But the problem is to mistakenly believe that the virtuoso somehow inherently isn't shocked by it. They have some secret for you. This is not true. They went through all these phases. At some point they went through the phase of being almost a virtuoso and being blown away and shocked by just how incredibly wise they were, and that they couldn't really share it with others in a calm way. They went through that phase too. So we have to be careful about virtuosity, actually. And it has to be abundantly clear about practice, and at the same hand, the virtuoso, we should not try to be blown away by our wisdom just to identify with those who are struggling, because that removes a very important part of their motivation. They say, hey, wait a minute, this is the end result? You're shocked, continually shocked by how your success? I don't want that. So we want to be a spiritual virtuoso, not shocked at all by our success. At the same hand, it's easy to misinterpret that. So there again, it's a fine line. It's a fine line. The path, narrow is the path, that is for sure. Which gets back to practice. Our practice is our key to success. Not the virtuoso. Our practice is the key to success. There's nothing greater than our own practice. That is the greatest of all. So if you're actually practicing, you're doing the greatest good you can possibly do. You are the greatest just already. Because it's your practice that is going to be the key to success. Not even the virtuoso, not even Jesus is the key to our success. It's our practice that is the key to success. All Jesus can do is reassure us and say, be gentle, forgive yourself, you know, and explain, try this. You know, he says, well, give this a try and see if you can imagine what it's like to know that God is truly within you and is will always be there and is totally loving and supportive. He says, even if you don't see it, see if you can imagine it. First kind of believe it, then imagine it, and then see it, and then know it. And you know, and just try. He says, just give this a try. And maybe we don't try for 20 years, and then finally we'll give it a little try. But he understands that. He understands that. Sometimes it's better to have the virtuosos at a distance, because we can get caught up in this syndrome of worshiping the seemingly effortlessness, and then trying to imitate that, you know. And we're great imitators and pretenders and actresses and actors, right? And so we can study these great teachers and say, okay, this is how I can act. This is how I can act. And then it's all an act. It's all, see, for the virtuoso, it's not an act. It's the continuity fear has finally evaporated for them. And so for them, it's just all easily apparent. There's no difficulty at all anymore. This is not something that we can imitate. It's not something we can imitate. We should not try to imitate the teachers. We should use the inspiration to practice. Which is why teachers often move around and don't hang out with anybody too long, because people can get it caught up into this imitation mode instead of practicing. On the other hand, it's an inspiration to hear a virtuoso. It's an inspiration for, like, piano players who are really into it, and they hear this and they say, wow, you know, it's just like no nerves, you know, just as easy. But then they can say, well, how do they do that? And then again, they should know. You see, they should know through this evaporating the continuity fear, through full stop in the wow is the way. And doing this bit by bit, many little times. Now, we could set aside a block of time, and in that block of time, we might go through many cycles of breakthroughs, and then wow, breakthroughs, many little practices. Instead of trying to just do it all, this one big wow, and I can get it just all at once. Because the all at once is the realization that nothing ever happened, and there's nothing to get. So you never get it all at once, because the all at once-ness is realization there isn't anything to get, actually. So it's sort of paradoxical. So it's useless for us to try and grasp that there's nothing to grasp when we're grasping this very tightly, this self-mockery, you see? And so practice. That's all I've done in one way or the other. Even though when I didn't think I was practicing, I didn't realize, because I wasn't doing something formal by recipe, by the book. This is, you know, what you're supposed to do. I was just sitting quietly, contemplating and trying to get glimpses of clarity, and then I would get them, and then I just say, wow, I just got a glimpse of clarity, and it's just wow. And then try to maintain my equilibrium. That's all I did. That's basically the path I've done. Then I realized, I saw how I reacted to this. I said, wow, I'm reacting, and this is so strong. What do I do? This reaction is, you know, how do I keep going? And actually, that is the path. That is this wowism. It's the path that everyone actually takes. Some people do it more formally, like, okay, I'm going to meditate on this, and they get some recipe. Some people cook with recipes. Some people don't use recipes. I don't use recipes. other people, they say, I can't cook without a recipe. I've got to have a recipe. I've got to have rules and regulations and all. And these are the people that generally end up promoting sort of dogmatic religions. They say, no, these are the rules you have to follow. This is, you have to, this is. And this gives them like structure. Are there problems with that, really? Because it gives the illusion that somehow the struggle shouldn't be there. As long as you follow these rules and everything, that there shouldn't be any struggle. So when the struggle happens, then it undermines your will. Say, wait a minute, maybe, and then you end up making a goal of it all. So you know, you got to get another fine line there between rules and regulations and being more abstract. And I was very abstract, like with the Course in Miracles. So you could say I've sat quietly most of my life, as I just sat quietly, like just like I'm sitting right now. But not just for the sake of sitting quietly or pretending, imitating some contemplator or anything, no. Because I found that this was the best way to concentrate. And I found that I really needed to concentrate in order to recognize why don't I just get a glimpse of freedom and then suddenly it disappears? This is the question that besets everyone. It's the most maddening thing ever, isn't it? And so then what you have to do is don't struggle. Don't say, oh, I just got a glimpse of my freedom and now it disappeared. Say, okay, great, that's fine. That's fine. I just opened the door and suddenly shut it again because I said, oh my gosh, that's too good. I can't believe it. I said, wow. Wow. I peeked through and, oh, wow. I was like, is that true? All my self-mockery is not true. I don't need it. Wow. So they just have to be kind and patient and forgiving. Don't lose your cool. You know, it's tough. It is very tough. And of course, you're going to lose your cool at times. Because everybody else is like getting it conceptually and imitating teachers. And, you know, it's like the academia, that there's some students that their whole game, it's a game, how to please the teacher. That's their game. Like for me in school, I could care less about pleasing the teacher. I was there to learn. What can I get out of this? So let me just see what I can get out of this. It's up to me what I get out of this class. And not up to the teacher, really. You know, they can give me a little assist, but no, it's me. And so, but many figured out the game. Okay, how can I please the teacher and get a good grade and give the answers they want? And so they become imitators. And they study in order to appease and please the teacher. That's not the path at all. And then you see the world with those who are getting so-called A's in the class because they learn the concepts and how to spin them and all this stuff. And you're still struggling away with all this. And you think, wow, I'm so slow. I'm going so slow. This is terrible. What's wrong with me? Everybody else is passing me by. Well, look at now, you know. Different story. So many are collapsing back into magical thinking. And I'm able to, you know, keep on going, at least so far. So it's a, you know, different story in a lot of ways. It's like the oak tree, you grow slowly. All these other trees are shooting up, you know, real fast, and you know, this little oak tree is going so slow. And the big oaks, and but you know, after what, 500 years or so, look at the oak tree, and where are the other trees? See, the oak tree has grown into some massively beautiful, huge. We have huge oak trees here, Valley Oaks. you know, just like there's nothing beats them for a tree. They're just like majestic. Yeah, you have the huge redwoods here too, which are majestic, but you can't even see the tops of them. But the oak trees there, just, it's just, you look at it and you say, wow, what a tree that is. And the other trees, you don't even pay attention. Another thing, there's a belief there's some collegiality between those on the path, and I found out there really isn't. there really isn't. It's assumed. Oh yeah, I'm far along the path, and you are too. So there's some collegiality. Not really. It's difficult to accept because we want friends on the path. We want help on the path. But actually, everyone's path is quite unique to them, and we cannot really understand. We can't understand. The path is not something we can understand. And I've never seen two people see eye to eye on the path. Never. Never. I've studied this my whole life. It's the most amazing thing. You get some very advanced, those are on the very advanced the path, explaining, etc. And those who ask the questions, everything, you can tell they're on different pages. They don't see eye to eye. They never do. They never do. And there's nothing we can do about this. So the path is sort of feels solitary. You keep thinking, well, how come we can't just all get along? And because the success is so stupendous, we can't even explain it. And what happens in explanations, you get the sharpest teachers around, those who are maybe expositors of a great teacher. And they're brilliant expositors of it. They can talk about it, and yet if you really listen to what they say with words, it's full of holes, completely full of holes. So it's easy to critique someone else, you see, especially when you're far along. You can look at someone who's brilliant, and anyone, and just look at it and say, wow. I can improve that by a hundredfold. Look at that, switch holes. This is not right. I can improve it. And you feel like I could do better than that. But the thing is, if you try to explain your way to them, they look at you and say, wait a minute, your explanation is full of holes. I can do way better than that. This is the problem. Because the explanations are not it. The explanations are not it. The practice is it. So we should not be. The collegiality is a collegiality of practice, not a dialogue, not of explanation so much, not an attempt at collegiality, let's put it that way. Certainly, sharing this clarity is positive. It's not an attempt at collegiality at all. It's very important to understand this. It's not an attempt to say, hey, yeah, we understand one another. No. What we understand is practice works. This is what we share and understanding. The rest of it, the explanation, no way. Like again, the dreams I had last night, there is no way I can explain that in words. I have many, many dreams where there's simply, I don't see any possible way to express it at all. In terms of what anyone can understand really here. No way. So the collegiality is one of practice. That's it. It's not one of discussion. It's not one of agreement. That's useless. Useless. I realize that. I came across someone's website. It's brilliant. And helpful. And yet I saw he was stuck. I see he's stuck, you know. I see how he's really stuck in this. And I said, I can help him. But I said, whoa. No. How can I help him? What am I talking about? My explanation, when he looks at my explanation, he's going to say, I'm stuck. You see, and he says, I can help you. You know, and then we're saying, oh, wait a minute, who's helping? You know, and then it gets all confusing. So all I could say to anyone is just keep practicing. And that will ultimately bring about your success, no matter what, how you've expressed it with words, no matter what, how you've expressed it. Success cannot really be expressed in words. It cannot. Cannot. Not even remotely expressed in words. So the idea that we understand these teachers is not true. It's not true at all. That's why Srinasargadatta Maharaj said, come on, stop talking. Just, you know, trust me. I'm telling you the truth. Just experience it for yourself and then tell me how, tell me if you have any questions. Because he says, you can't explain it. You cannot explain it. So it's not teachable. The truth is not teachable. And of course, we think that we can explain it. You cannot explain it. You can only practice until you get it. That's it. So explanation should be geared towards practice. But this too is a, can be a problem. Everything can be a problem if it's overdone. So the spiritual path should be geared towards actual practice, is a way to put it. And so what I try to do is what I'm saying is full stop in the wow, bringing up this continuity fear and keeping it simple, keeping it simple, keeping it simple. What's very important is to keep the practice simple. Don't try to overthink it. And even there, people will differ. Some will just do inquiry into I. They put attention, full attention on I. And what I say is just full stop in the wow of when we recognize. But what do we do when we put our attention on the I, for instance, or whatever you want to call it, the completeness, the inherent completeness, the untouchedness, the that which has no struggle to be what it is. Or even just recognizing, what happens then? Obviously, we have a wow reaction. So where's our attention then? Do we struggle to put it back on the eye? No. I say, don't struggle with the struggle. We're struggling away from the eye. Then say, okay, great. Very nice. Great effort. Pat yourself on the back. Great effort to recognize something. I don't even know what... You know, there's a lot of different ways of talking about this term I, you know, which is and I've brought them up before, which is fine. But more importantly than any of that is once you get a glimpse of whatever it is we're talking about, what happened? What then? Full stop in the wow is then. You have something to grab a hold of. Oh yeah, full stop in the wow. Great. No problem. Everything's fine. So then you don't need to overthink the path, which is the problem that people have. They overthink it so much, or they flip it conversely, they try to underthink it so much. They try to underthink it, and they say, well, there is no path. But they're only doing that to underthink it. It's true that there is no path at all. But that's only understandable in a certain context. It's not meant to be that practice isn't the path. We're gripping self-mockery too tightly. We need to relax our grip. But it's true that self-mockery never ever went anywhere. So it's not like we're, you know, it's not like we're journeying back to what we are, because what we are is always right present. So it's not like a path in that regard, but the path of practice, you can talk as a path of practice, of realizing we don't need any practice to be what we are. There is no path to completing what we are. This is another way of putting it. There is no path to completing what we are. We're already complete. So we're just setting down this idol of incompleteness is all we're doing. We're letting, not setting it down, we're loosening our grip on this idol of incompleteness. And that seems like a path because it takes a while. You know, were very hesitant to do this. Some more so than others, but all are quite hesitant, for sure. Now, some are like an avatar, or who have been enlightened previously and come back as a bodhisattva of compassion, the savior of compassion or something, like Ramana Maharshi. He didn't have any, he didn't really have any of that continuity fear. Didn't have any sense of incompleteness, you know, or anything need to be completed. So he was just able to one day say he was gripped with this extreme grip fear of death, which is just simply what culture had built up as a proposition to him. And what he did is he just then set it down. He just set it down, and that's it. Done. But believe me, this either he was an avatar, which didn't have any of this carryover karma, or he'd already burned off all this karma, which means really continuity fear. Already done it. And the reason why he was gripped with a sudden fear of death was, again, this is what the world was offering him for his life. He's saying, here, this can be your life here. And he just spontaneously, this was not going to be his life. The purpose was already there. And then he said, okay, now it's time to set this, choose, and I'm going to set down this offer of fear of death and dying and impermanence. I'm going to set that down. That's not my purpose here. And he just set it down like that. Just set it down. You know, very unusual, but due to previous efforts, successful practice. And which he himself said very clearly, you know, anyone who succeeds is because of practice, tremendous effort. But when we put in the tremendous effort, we should succeed. Absolutely, we should succeed. We should become the virtuoso at some point. Absolutely, of course. And this is what a spiritual culture promotes, is there are quite a few that have succeeded. And people see that, and they say, of course, you put in the work and you get the fruit. Whereas nowadays, everything's based on the supposition that we're supposed to do quick. So when someone does it, everyone says, wow, okay, how'd you do it? Explain to me. This is incredible. How'd you do it so fast? And I said, I didn't do it fast. Well, you don't expect me to do it slow. I got to do it fast. You know, I'm educated. I'm smart. This is why education gets in our way. Is we think that the smarter we get in our education, the quicker we're supposed to be able to do stuff. And therefore, the spiritual path, we sort of a priori, we're rejecting it, saying, wait a minute. This must be stupid. This path must be people must have been stupid to take this path because they spent their whole lives. That's stupid. They say they must not have been very smart. Then they say, well, the goal must not be very smart or worthy then either because of it. They must have been stupid, and stupid people choose stupid goals. So you see how this whole thing, mockery of God, is gains momentum in the world. The more we overvalue our education that we have, we overvalue our secular education to an extraordinary extent, and this is part of the sickness of this world. I stopped valuing that when I was like 12 years old. I said, this is ridiculous. This is way overvalued. I said, I go home and study these books and spiritual teachings. This is way more important than this nonsense I'm getting in school. And is that the new year? Let me see. No, it's not yet. It'll start picking up the pyrotechnics. So we have the stigma, that's an insidious stigma in the world now, which is what I've been commenting on this my whole life, saying, look out. There's a building stigma in this world which is going to cause an enormous trouble. And it's an unspoken stigma. You know, stigmas don't have to be spoken. It's just everyone, by their, what everything they do, they're in compliance with the stigma, saying, hey, this is a stigma. If you're not educated, it's a stigma. You know, you don't have a college degree, that's a stigma. You're not intelligent. And the goals that you pursue are not as intelligent as the goals that the college-educated people pursue. And if it, you know, and then the stigma of taking a long time to accomplish something. It's like, how long have you been, you know, practicing the piano? You're virtual, how long? Well, I mean, it took me about 45 years to get to this point. They go, you're what an idiot. They say, what a stupid. And they start thinking, it must not be being a virtuoso, so it's not that important. You know, it can't be. It can't be. So the rationalization is saying, I'm smart, I'm super smart, I have a degree, I've been trained to do stuff faster, learn how to do it real quick, and therefore, this is a sign of my intelligence, and therefore, anything that takes a long time and then struggles, don't struggle, that's beneath me, must be beneath me, therefore, the goal of this can't be that valuable, it really can't be. See, then a stigma builds up about pursuing goals that aren't valuable, don't have value, right? And then, you know, it's like, God, it's not really valuable to pursue that goal. And you get this overall cultural stigma that nobody needs to say it. It's just tacitly accepted. And this is the insidiousness that's crept in with modern education, modern pop culture, pop psychology, all this stuff, corporate, cosmic corporate culture, I call it. It's insidious. That's why it's called a snake. Snakes creep up on you. You don't even hear them creeping up on you. And before you know it, they bite you. You know? It's like, how did that get here? It scares the heck out of you. You know, where's other big animals? You can hear them coming, you know, or maybe the elephant. You can hear the elephant coming or something. But the snake, you don't ever hear it coming. And so cosmic corporate culture, the symbols, this serpentine snake, it's very insidious. And these stigmas get built up, stigmas get built up, and we have terrible stigmas in the world now about the path to God realization, and it's how it seems to be this plausible illogic of the goal can't be really worthy because it takes you too long, and therefore you can't be that smart, and therefore stupid people don't choose wise goals. So you know, see that logic. Illogic, actually, and that illogic turned into a stigma. Overvaluing our education, overvaluing materiality, overvaluing all of this. This is what happens when a society is collapses into darkness, is they overvalue the wrong stuff. We don't value our elders anymore, do we? This is a huge sign. I've noticed this incredible lack of valuing I feel from younger people. Not everyone, of course. There's some exceptions, but in general, you can say it's a shocking attitude of young people towards the older people. Like, look at these useless eaters. You know, they're good for nothing. You know, what have they accomplished? You know, they can't be that important. Where's their success? You know, I'm still working on my success. I haven't reached that. It's a lifelong goal, like an old big oak tree. They don't value the big oaks. You know, they value immediate gratification and immediate success. And so the old people don't have any value to the younger people anymore, which is disastrous. Because what motivation is there anybody to really try to take their time and get it right and spend a lifetime on it? Like a craftsman doing something a lifetime, take them a lifetime to do this. Where they're not going to be valued by anybody. So it's a stigma. There's a stigma about now older age, older people. Terrible stigma where they can't have anything of value, really. It would have shown up long before. And if it hasn't shown up yet, it can't be anything of value. The old age has nothing of value. Well, the value for me, for instance, is finally reaching the goal, you know, liberation from duality and accepting singularity, taking refuge in the impenetrable citadel, unassailable citadel of silence, taking refuge in the unassailable citadel of silence. In spiritual culture, of course, it's realized that usually it takes a lifetime to reach this. So older people, elders who have reached it are greatly valued, and being older is greatly valued, understanding that, hey, it may take you that long to get there. So don't take your eye off the prize. Don't undervalue a lifetime of effort like this. And then so the younger people are encouraged, hey, it's okay to pursue this goal, and it may take you a long time. And it's okay to reach it in your older years. That's great. That's fine. Because it's just once you reach it, you're liberated from all age entirely. Death, age, all of this, it's nothing to you, actually. You don't feel that, actually, at all. You feel eternally fresh. And so you value that and you realize, hey, this is what I can do. So that's called a spiritual culture. Valuing a lifetime of effort towards reaching a goal. Not saying that means you're stupid. It means the goal that it can't be worthy. It's saying, yeah, it is a totally worthy goal. If you look at all old people and say, there's nothing worthy they can attain at all. They're tired. They're worn out. There can't be anything worthy they attain. So even if I'm enlightened, people say, oh, that can't be that worthy of a goal because, it took him too long. So he's older. And that's can't be that important. Then it's devalued by their, lack of clear reasoning. And so that puts more pressure on people to do it now, right? No delay. Just let's do it. Just instantly, instant gratification, instant enlightenment. And that doesn't work very well at all, does it? And you get into this dual allegiance thing. It's a very slippery slope. It's saying, yeah, I can have everything now. All material goods, all material success. I can, all that kind of stuff. So, as I've said, the culture has overvalued many, many, many situations to a disastrous extent. And it puts a roadblock up for success. Because again, the continuity fear is so severe, it's likely to take just about everybody a lifetime of effort. 30, 40 years is very possible. Maybe even 50 in some cases, and maybe even 60. And some I may not even quite even make it. The path it's so stunning that our efforts didn't do anything. We're so stunned by this. No matter, we put all our creativity into trying to change reality, and it had no effect whatsoever. And this is profound for us. It stuns us. It shocks us. We're just, it takes quite a bit of adjusting to this to say, like, wow, I can't change what I am. This is just an incredible realization. I cannot change what I am. It's the heart of profundity, the very heart of profundity. And so you just don't go from believing that there's no profundity to leaping straight into the heart of profundity. It just doesn't happen that way. That's a pipe dream. That is really a pipe. So I think this culture is living a pipe dream. They really are living a pipe dream. They think that they can apply this, high tech somehow, they can apply all this to the spiritual path and just say, yeah, we can, we just got an app for that, no problem, just download the app. That's it, that's all you need. This is a pipe dream. Living in a pipe, having a pipe dream. Severely overvaluing what should not be valued so highly. Not that it doesn't have some pragmatic, practical usage. You can say all sorts of things can have practical usage, and depending where you are. I mean, if you live in the Arctic, snowshoes are very practical, right? Here, you don't need snowshoes, right? So it depends what is practical and what is not. But don't overvalue it. Don't say like snowshoes are it everywhere, because here we don't need walking around in snowshoes. Here is ridiculous. So, education, to be a bean counter, that's got practicality to it, to be a bean counter. But on the spiritual path, being a bean counter is not, doesn't have any value at all. You're not going to count like, okay, yesterday I did such and such, and I did have two to three breakthroughs. You don't catalog everything. This becomes ridiculous. That's not the way. So, but it has practical usage in a few areas. But don't overvalue it and say, this is it. That's folly. That is folly. Chilly out here, but it's no wind, so that's okay. I've gone on a health kick after Christmas. Got the Nutribullet, and I just been seeing what can I do. What does it taste like? And I'm getting more and more adventurous. Which is just right where you go. First, I start out very, very careful, a little banana and an orange, you know, and more and more gradually adding stuff. And now, you know, I planted this incredible mix that is just like, oh, my, take a look at this, yeah. This, what you're looking at is kale and flaxseed, basically. I put kale and flaxseed, half an apple, and chia seed, and sunflower seeds. That's it. And some cran raspberry juice. But it was a ton of kale. I just stuffed the whole thing full of kale, fresh kale leaves, threw a bunch of flaxseed, a lot of flaxseeds in here. And it's very heavy and very thick. As you can see, it's very thick and tough to drink. The bottoms out. Wow. Flaxseed is amazing. What it does, it's like gelatin almost. It just puffs and fills up and just makes things so thick. Wow. That's my dinner. Drinking this. Well, I can't drink that much. It's so thick. You don't think the flaxseeds, what do? They just absorb the moisture and just thicken it all up. Put how many leaves? Like 4 big leaves of kale and chopped it all up, put it in there. Crazy. So just saying, what the heck, let's have some fun. Let's throw some chia seeds and some flax seeds, kale together, see what it tastes like. But supposed to be very healthful for you. Those are two of the super health foods. Now kale is all the rage, of course. It is the rage. It's supposed to be like awesomely healthy for you. And flax seeds too, those two. It's gonna take me a while to drink that one. I gotta get my courage up to drink the whole thing. I don't think I'll do that again quite like, not so many flax seeds. I think I put in too many. But it doesn't cause any problem, you know. It seems to be okay. In the morning, it was a banana, cashews and walnuts, cran raspberry juice, and an orange, something like that. Yeah, some seeds. Oh, pumpkin seeds. A lot of pumpkin seeds I threw in this morning. So pumpkin seeds, cashews, and walnuts with banana and orange and cran raspberry juice and some lime juice. Very good. Very, you could feel rich, you know, cashews and walnuts, pureed cashews and walnuts and pumpkin seeds. That's rich. So I didn't drink all of it. It lasts. You drink that in the morning, you know, you feel good to go most of the day. So this is like a ridiculous health kick. I never thought I'd do anything like this, but I figured, why not? It's fun for a while. I don't think I'll spend the rest of my life drinking this kale and flaxseed juice. I hope not. But it's a good time to detox, you know? It's a good time to detox. Great time to detox, actually. It took me about 4 or 5 days to get my courage up to even try any of these greens. Yesterday I tried spinach and kale, and I said, okay, I can handle that. Let me try straight kale. That's on the edge. It's getting a little edgy. Not bad, but it's a little edgy. I drew the line at mustard greens and collard greens and stuff. Not quite ready for that yet, because I know how those taste, and that gets a little bitter. It's like drinking some sort of tonic. You know, we all in this world, we have kind of like what's called spiritual Alzheimer's. We forget who we are. We forget not who, but what. We forget that what we are cannot be contained by anything. It's not contained at all. There's nothing we can say defines that this is containing what we are. This is the definition of what we are. It's going to be contained. So we have spiritual Alzheimer's. And, you know, there's a cure for it. But many say, there is no cure. You know, there is no cure for this. As they say, like, there's no cure for Alzheimer's or, you know, something. Well, okay. Is the problem Alzheimer's? No. The problem is spiritual Alzheimer's. It's not physical Alzheimer's, it's spiritual. We have spiritual Alzheimer's disease, and that is curable through practice, right practice. Buddha said the Dharma, which is really mean all the skillful means. You know, there's a lot of skillful means can be used, a lot of practice, but boil it all down to what? Practice, 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 practice. That's it. So we can cure spiritual Alzheimer's, but each one of us has to do it for ourselves, because we want to do it, and we realize we don't need to hang on to it. How do we cure spiritual Alzheimer's? By realizing we don't need it and we don't want it. That's how. Not by drinking a kale and flaxseed mixture. That doesn't cure it. It might, yeah, but it might detox our system, body a little bit, give us some energy, give us, you know, it's, but it doesn't, yeah, that's not the cure. Problem is this spiritual problem of continuity fear. We've been telling ourselves we need self-mockery. That's, we have to have that. If we don't have that, we're nothing. And then we realize we don't need it. We don't need it. We think this is like benefiting reality. Like we have to have both. Reality isn't complete without our mockery of it. This is not true. This is not true. Well, I don't want to get frozen here before the new year. New year, what's it going to be like? I think a lot of heavy work, a lot of heavy workload. That's good. In some way, you know, in some way, heavy workload and careful, dealing with a lot of sharp objections. Doesn't have to be sharp objections, you have to be, you know, take your time. Take your time. The stigma. Don't get stuck by the stigma. So I'll probably be working through, you know, the stigma quickly, working quickly, but slowing down to go fast, right? Don't struggle. And how are we doing that? I don't know. That remains to be seen. The stigma is so insidious in this world. People don't even realize they have it. They don't even realize they have it. And it's a great shock to them when they realize they have it. And what do you do then? They begin to rationalize and get defensive and all this stuff. So what I say is full stop in the wild. Practice is better. Is the best remedy for our situation is practicing, as I call this, wowism, a full stop in the wow, meaning I just had a breakthrough, now what do? Oh, let me just be patient and let this, don't berate myself for, you know, jumping back a little bit. Just pat myself on the back, great job, terrific, really this is great, it's so great, it's stunning, I was just temporarily stunned, that's okay, you know. And then give yourself the right and the patience to go slowly. But this is where the stigma tries to hit us, saying, oh, you know, press your advantage. This is a competition. You have to defeat something. You have to defeat the ego. You got to win. And then the ego, you know, mocking you. No. So, no, it's not. The way to, quote-unquote, win is to slow down and go faster. I say, great job. What a stunning advance you just made. That is terrific. You talk to yourself this way, like, well, that was just, I just made a stunning advance. That is fantastic, wonderful. And now I'm just suffering back, you know, backlights are jumping back from a little bit. But then calm your nerves, calm your nerves, calm your nerves. It's a matter of calming your nerves. Say, okay, no trouble, no trouble. Don't struggle, don't force yourself to think about it and figure it out. You see, I already had the glimpse. I already had it figured out. So, I did the work. Now I have to do the work of patience. So it's perspiration and patience. Is you make the effort to make progress, and then you have to be patient to let the aftermath of that progress die down. Let the dust settle. And that's it. And the more the stigma is attached to practice and this slowing down to go faster, of course, the more difficult it becomes. Collectively, the stigma the world is building up. So my concern is going to build up too much here. This is a possibility from my standpoint. It's possible. I don't know if this is true or not. I'm not sure. But it certainly wouldn't surprise me if it builds up too much in this world. And then, you know, what's the remedy for that? Not sure. Not sure. But in the meantime, though, we should practice as much as possible. So, we can take refuge in the unassailable citadel of this, what we could call silence, is one way to refer to it. It's really inherent completeness. The singularity, right? Apparent completeness. Or it doesn't need a co-completion. Co-completion. Doesn't need co-completion. Doesn't need something, a hero to triumph over something. It's never needed a triumph to be complete. See, it's never needed any triumph whatsoever. So there's no attainment, there's no triumph of the path. You know, like that is realization that's never been needed. It's like saying enlightenment has never been needed, attainment has never been needed in terms of a co-attainment. Something saying, you know what, I've finally completed completeness, or here's an extra completeness, or something. None of that's ever been needed. And that's the only thing we've been trying to do, is find some co-completeness to reality. And it just, we realize it's never needed. It's never needed. It's not needed now, it's never needed, so there isn't any path to making it needed. There's no path to necessity. And there's no path to non-necessity, because it was never needed. So it's not like it's needed, but we're finding a path to it not being needed. It's never been needed. So ultimately, no path is needed. Okay, Happy New Year to everybody, and remember that our success is actually off the charts, and it stuns us, and this is the only trouble we have, is we get stunned by our success. But there's no way around that, because we have to be incredibly successful, to even to the point of realizing, I don't need any co-necessity, I don't need any co-success, I don't need any co-completion at all. So our success is actually ultimate, totally ultimate, totally ultimate. So be patient and kind and forgiving with yourself during 2:15. Slow down to go faster, and we will see how that works out for us. Okay, very great. Happy New Year.